You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome to the seventh story for the month of February, issue 209. I hope that this podcast is finding you extraordinarily well. What have your thoughts been over the last few stories? You can always send us an email. I'm Kate at ClarkesworldMagazine.com. I read each and every one of them. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to both listen and to write. And also, I want to thank you again for your support. Please go to patreon.com/Clarkesworld to see how you can help us make back some of the income we lost when Amazon decided they were just going to do things differently. Again, that's patreon.com/Clarkesworld, and that is Clark with an E. Our story is titled The Beam Eidolon and is by Ryan Marie Ketterer. Ryan Marie Ketterer is from Malden, Massachusetts. Her work can be found in Dark Matter Magazine and CHM, as well as several anthologies. She's a fan of the weird and uncanny, and her writing draws most of its influence from the works of Shirley Jackson and Thomas Ligotti. When she isn't writing stories, Ryan is writing code for a software startup in Boston, Massachusetts, or training for another road race. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. The wind blows through me, around me, and I creep under, over, and around the trees, the leaves, the dirt. Today, the star shines, and I absorb it into my nutrient-rich ocean, those decadent rays, using them to grow stronger, better. My world, this world belongs to me, and it is perfect. Or at least, it was, until they came. It was not just any other day, it was a special day, a day on which this world regenerates and celebrates. It was the festival of salt. The sky was blue, small clouds floating in the atmosphere. The briny sea lapped up over smooth stones lining the fine sand on the various beaches across the planet. But one beach in particular brought together everything and everyone. Bird snakes circled above, ice ants crawled down from the mountains, enduring the star's heat for the festival. To celebrate the beam Eidolon. It was tall, this effigy, and triangular in shape. It was made of polished, shiny stone, created only from generations of wear, and sat up upon an expansive swath of sand, irreverent and sturdy. At its peak, high in the air, was a dull white crystallized peak. And so, as more of me arrived, the tiger monkeys and three-eyed sloths bounded in from deep within the jungle. The anticipation grew. All of us, all of me, that dared step near the beam Eidolon, did so with respect. It was time for me to churn the once calm, salty seas, and as I did, white caps formed, bigger and bigger waves pushing over the shoreline. The creatures of this world began to dance, a chaotic yet beautiful sight, as each successive swell neared the Eidolon. When the water started sloshing against the base of the great idol, its crystalline tip flickered, light trying to escape. The movement of every living thing around it continued to pulse as the excitement grew. I persisted with the now heavy ocean, getting closer and closer to the ultimate climax. The brackish water climbed high, eventually pouring over the top of the beam, Eidolon, and it is then that we beheld its rare power. A great white light shot from the apex of our deity, and we celebrated when the overly salted water engulfed the entire beam. Life soaked deep into me, deep into our very existence here. The festival of salt had culminated in a grand sight once again, as it does every trip around our star. The glow was beautiful. It was perfect. But we barely had time to celebrate this wondrous occasion. There were monsters in the sky. I'd seen nothing like them before. They weren't like the three-eyed sloths. These new monsters had only two eyes, the slithering beetles. They had limbs, four to be exact. The new monsters were tall as the short trees at least, but not as tall as the tall ones. One of them was different though, much smaller. It walked on all fours and had bright, orange, fluffy fur. They made noises unfamiliar to me, to this whole planet. They didn't know I was surrounding them, lurking and afraid. I was on the branches hanging from above, so close to their round heads. I sat in the flowers in between the flecks of pollen, listening to them and committing to memory the noises they made. I repeated those noises to myself. One sounded like Polly. Later that night, when the star went away and brought its light with it, I laid in between the granules of sand near the Beam Eidolon, still glowing until day's end, and tried it out. Polly. 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 It sounded good on me, didn't it? Polly. I let myself sink into the ocean, my wonderful salty ocean, my source of life, my power, while I continued to say, Polly. I dispersed, wanting to return to the monsters to learn more. I found where they slept, their limbs curled, and watched from the vegetation that surrounded them. I would wait for the star to come back. The Pollies heard me. Must have dozed off, let my cart down. I awoke to a sharp pain as they cracked tree branches and set them ablaze. I wallowed in silence, hoping to not provoke them further when they suddenly crunched the fragile shells of slithering beetles between their mandibles. What have I done to deserve this pain? Why must they torture me so? These Pollies, as I had decided they should be called, these monsters, they disturbed me. I ran away, back to the coast, to the ocean, to the one place I felt most safe and trembled under the shadows of the ever-changing atmosphere, while restoring my energy, my very vitality, from the salty ocean waters. Without that shimmering blue vastness, I'm not sure I could continue to exist. The Beam Eidolon had finally dimmed back to its regular state, and I could only wait in anticipation of the Festival of Salt to return again. I wondered if there was a way to make these intruders suffer, these intruders, to my sanctum. Was there a way to tell these Pollies that they are not welcome here? Shall I set the jungle on them, rip them apart, and feast on their insides? Or do I scare them off, hoping they don't return? Oh, but I knew that wouldn't satisfy me. No, I knew I must torture them, like they had tortured me. I could still feel their pokes and prods, their stamping on the forest floor, even from here, even from so far away. I underestimated how much these Pollies would use me. They foraged my plants from the dirt, ripping decades-old and deep-rooted tree trunks for their selfish reasons. It felt like a foreign hand reaching deep within my soul and picking it apart, doing with it some nefarious act. My only hope was to continue to make myself one with the Pollies. Yes, that's right. My essence is everything here. Everything. Including all the things they have eaten, that they have breathed in. I have begun the slow process of injecting my limitless vitality into these monsters that have invaded me. While I waited, I tried to listen to their words, but the pain of their actions overwhelmed me. Polly, what now? We made it here, just like you said, but what now? One Polly asked. Well, it's safe, ain't it? We need to find a way to go back to tell people they can come here. That was the Polly speaking, the leader. A third different Polly then said, we're just kids. How do you suggest we do that? The worst pain they caused, though, the unspeakable, was when they began digging around the Beam Eidolon. I had hoped that they would never venture that far, that they would never even lay eyes on our divine idol. They had formed tools that allowed them to burrow deep into the ground, past the topsoil and down into where the rocks grew in size. A long trench surrounded the beam now. The Pollies bickered and I sobbed to myself as their sharp contraptions punctured me over and over again. I continued to weaken, but my resolve held strong. I learned new sounds like engineering and rocket and trust me. I did not understand these words, but I needed to figure out a way to use them. Time became irrelevant. The Festival of Salt had not happened since these monsters arrived. It was not possible, not without the Beam Eidolon, which was now dismantled into pieces. The Polly said this was innovative, to find and use new material for whatever it is they were doing. This planet has a wealth of new materials, the Polly said with a childish confidence, gesturing at the remaining pieces of Beam Eidolon. It would be irresponsible to not use them. Oh, how they've damaged me so. They've cracked away pieces of my deity, pieces of me, and pounded them thin. Never once did the beam lose its shine, though. The thing they built stood tall, a foreign object to this planet, even though it was made of all my wonderful resources. It was circular, conic, pointy. The silver sheen was unmistakable, and I sobbed. Every once in a while, all four Pollies climbed inside. I wanted to hear what they said inside their contraption, and so I moved closer, rolling under the dirt and around the rocks, jumping from tree branch to hanging vine until I was near. In a moment of fear and uncertainty, I moved into their shiny structure, unsure of what would happen, if they would know. And then I was around them, one with the fractured Eidolon, one the vaunted material that once belonged to me. I felt free. I felt as if I had reclaimed something. They had taken from me all of these things, and just now I had taken back a small piece. Luckily, their little edifice didn't change when I returned myself to it, at least not visibly. The Pollies had no idea I was with them. But how will it even run? One Polly asked. We don't have a way to power this, right? Connie, how many times do I need to say, this place is different, better than Earth. The ocean water, we can use it as a sort of fuel to launch us back. The ocean water? Not my ocean water, surely. That would be... The Polly continued. I've already started creating a pipeline straight from the beach to here. The water will get pulled in straight to the ship, and it should contain enough power to launch us into the atmosphere. Then we just need to find the hole. A hole? My essence quivered. If these monsters took my ocean, I would not be able to survive. I don't see a way to stop them. This pipeline that the Polly mentioned weeks ago is finished, and water flows between the ocean and their structure. The crystalline peak of the beam, Eidolon, now sits on top of their structure, pathetic mockery of what it once was. I don't understand how it works or how much of my life they're going to take, but the time to take action is now. My essence is the bugs and the flowers and the slithering beetles. My lifeblood is the ocean. The Pollies have eaten the beetles and bugs and snakes from my dirt. They have swallowed the water from my streams. They have torn down the only entity I worshipped. Are you sure this is going to work? It has to. It has to, surely. There's no other option. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God! The Polly rocked as it shouted. We're going to die, aren't we? They're frantic. They sit in a ring inside this travesty they call a rocket ship. The whole thing rumbles. There's brightness and unfamiliar noises, I am afraid. It was painful, once again forcing myself back into the remnants of the beam, Eidolon. It was painful to become again something I thought I no longer was. This planet is me, and I am all of it. And now I am them. I have finally finished assimilating into the Pollies, into the foods they ate. I am the Pollies now. They will live forever with me here on this planet, suffering, and there is nothing. It's working! The structure shakes and begins to lift. I feel pieces of my essentiality fracture. The dirt is distance. The slithering beetles, I can't access them. I can't be them. What is happening to me? Look, Polly, look. We're above the trees now. I splinter. Pieces of me, fundamental chunks of my existence fall away, leaving me broken. We're going back to Earth. We're going to make it back to Earth, finally. I swarm in the blood of the Pollies in between the follicles on their skin, through the strands of their hair. Above us, at the very top of this awful system they have made, I see a familiar glow. The festival of salt. I know not what these Pollies have done, but they have somehow harnessed the undeniable power of the beam, Eidolon, even in this mutilated state. We continue to climb into the air, entering darkness, a darkness that is lit only by the energy of the beam. I am the beam, and I am the Pollies now, and I will get my revenge on these monsters. And wherever it is, they are returning to. What are your thoughts on the story? We have one more story for you for the month of February. I do hope you can come back and listen, and then jump in to March with us. Until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.